I am Joe Rendacci, and this is the 9th episode in my podcast series called How to Fake It When. In each episode, we focused on important moments of our lives that we suck at and explore how you can better fake it until you make it. So join us for a thought-provoking session of some fact, some fiction, and a little bit of fun that looks to explore the reality and wretchedness of human interaction. As always, we begin with a shout out to our sponsor for this episode. Today, in keeping with our topic of mental health, the call out goes to Bob's Caribou Ludes. Bob's pills are made from the finest non-sanctioned FDA chemicals all the way from Canada, where when you feel like you're just about to have one of those silly little psychopathic tendency episodes rising up in you, pop one of these babies in your system and it will knock you out so cold that you won't even feel Santa and his flying caribou stomping on your head. Introducing my co-host, as I do in each episode, it's AI. And if you still don't know by now, it's not AI as in artificial intelligence. It's far from intelligence. That was episode 7, by the way, and that was just a shameless plug, but I'll take it at this point. This AI is the asshole inside of me. No, I'm not joking. And yes, you will be hearing his voice. Say hello, AI. Come on now. Now you're going to make me seem insane to the audience? After 8 episodes? I think they probably have it figured out by now. Oh, I get it. You're specifically giving me the silent treatment now because we're talking about psychopaths who hear voices in their head? Clever.
Thank you.
Ah, I knew that would get you.
Loser.
Anyhow, let's get to the factual portion of the show. Psychopathy is the psychological condition. Psychopaths are what we call the individual. Same goes for sociopathy and sociopaths. Distinguishing scientifically between psychopathy and sociopathy isn't, wait for it, an exact science, and these terms are often used interchangeably and represent overlapping, but not exactly identical concepts. They both do fall under antisocial personality disorder, acronymed as ASPD, because that's what we need, another acronym on mental health. But based on clinical perspectives, there are some differences in the traits for each, starting with roots of behavior. Psychopathy is believed to have genetic factors and neurobiological differences, such as abnormalities in brain structure or function. Or, in plain English, you have a screw loose and no screwdriver handy.
No one wants to screw you.
Ugh, that's a whole other psychological podcast I could run. Sociopathy is more tied to environmental factors like upbringing, social influences, or traumatic experiences like your wife making you watch too many Lifetime or Hallmark movies. That's a thing. Next up would be personality traits. Sociopathy is characterized by a disregard for social norms, deceitfulness, and a lack of remorse or guilt. They're often unable to control their emotions. Psychopaths, on the other hand, typically exhibit traits such as superficial charm and calmness. So combined with a lack of empathy and a knack for manipulativeness, they know how to play the game of life.
The board game?
No, moron, not the board game.
I'm already bored.
So which of these conditions are you?
Why don't you tell me, since you're talking to yourself?
Let's continue. Of course, sociopaths tend to be highly reactive to perceived slights or threats, and then often respond with aggressive, impulsive actions. They tend to have difficulty forming and maintaining stable relationships. Psychopaths can potentially control their emotions, and even with a lack of emotion and love, maintain that relationship longer. So, think Hannibal Lecter in Silence of the Lambs. Calm, cool, eloquent manners. Total psychopath. Thought people tasted the same as chicken. But what about Buffalo Bill? His patient and the kidnapping killer that Jodie Foster as Clarice finds and kills? Yes, everything screams psychopath about Buffalo Bill, but there's a lot of sociopathic tendencies in him. Perceived slights, aggressive responses. So again, not an exact science. And for the last point of differences, psychopathy is more commonly diagnosed in male individuals than in females.
No surprise there.
True, men suck. At least that's what my wife keeps saying. Next up, diagnosis. Well, diagnosis is difficult. For one thing, a psychopath would need to clearly know they're a psychopath and submit themselves for testing. So imagine running that one by your boss when asking for the day off. Psychopathy is typically diagnosed using specialized assessment tools such as the HAIR psychopathy checklist and treatments that include CBT, which is cognitive behavioral therapy. But the effectiveness for treatment of psychopathy is limited. It isn't like chicken soup makes your tummy better.
Nobody said there'd be soup.
You hungry?
I could eat.
Well, there's nothing that tastes like chicken here. So, overall, psychopathy is rare in the general population, with estimates suggesting that around 1% of the people of the world meet the criteria for psychopathy. Does that make you feel better? That there's 1%?
Yes.
Well, it shouldn't. There's 8 billion people out there. So 1% is 8 million psychotics running around out there. That's a lot of Hannibal Lecters cruising out there for their own hand-picked, finger-licking good chicken tenders.
Okay, now I'm not hungry.
So that's the clinical terms and definitions. All clear? Well, it shouldn't be. There was a lot of leeway in there. In practical terms, not clinical terms, if I get mad at you and think I'd really like to stick a pencil in your eye, but I don't do it, then I'm more of a sociopath. If I sharpen that #2 graphite weapon and bury it deep because we don't see eye to eye...
God, didn't just say that.
I didn't think it was that bad. But anyhow, that would wade me deep in the psychopath end of the pool. So, the way we have autistic spectrum scales, we have something like a 1 to 100 sliding scale here too.
When is actually sticking a pencil in their eye rate?
I don't know. 69?
69? That's a very telling number.
Where's that pencil? Well, now that we have the terms down, let's look at how to spot a sociopath versus a psychopath amongst CEOs. First scenario has Robbie Reporter, 6 months out of his liberal arts degree and part-time job asking if they would like fries with that, and is doing his first real interview with BD Swingin', chief executive officer for XYZ Company.
What do they do?
I don't know. What does it matter?
It matters.
Fine. They sell emotional service dogs.
Did your mother not love you enough?
Too much, and for that I needed an emotional service elephant, but we're way off topic. So, back to the scenario. So, Robbie enters his office and quietly sits in front of BD's desk as BD sits facing his window while still on a phone call. BD turns to Robbie without so much as a grin and continues to just keep talking on his call. Robbie starts to feel uneasy as 5 more minutes pass and he wishes he had his emotional service piggy right now with him. Finally, BD ends his call and faces the cub reporter. BD doesn't blink at all as he stares at Robbie. And once Robbie's deodorant fails him, he sheepishly sputters out a few nicey-nice introduction lines. BD still hasn't blinked and his eyes look like the portal to the graves of 1,000 tortured souls. And just before Robbie can ask question #1, as he feels he's just pooped #2 in his boxes, BD confidently smiles and displays the warm persona of a man whose heart is made from teddy bear tummies and puppy dog noses. From this point, BD owns the conversation as he shares tales of conquer over rival companies and acquisitions of partner firms. Some were considered risky, some were considered daring, and BD did them all without a raised heartbeat or a blink of the eye. And this is where we get tip #1. The eyes have it. And this is where Robbie should have done his homework in the Uber ride over. Had he Googled that CEOs share many traits of psychopaths, two of them would be that they're very manipulative and usually have that no blinking crazy eye look, usually reserved for single women over 40.
That's going to get some hate mail for one specific male. You.
Am I wrong?
You're not wrong.
Now, even though we have an ice in the veins, no blinking, eyes with a passage to hell CEO and BD here, this doesn't mean he's a psychopath who's dangerous. While there's probably skeletons in his closet, in the figurative term, that doesn't mean the remains of his adversaries, ex-wives, and secretary are literally in there. Though his secretary has been missing for 3 days, and maybe Robbie should be covering that story. Now, just because I said it doesn't mean he is a psychopath, it doesn't mean he isn't either. In this scenario, Robbie made it all the way home to change his boxers, so he lived happily ever after.
That was a horrible situational example.
Which brings us up to tip number two. Trust no one. You can think someone is a total psychopath, and then you find out they won't even step on a spider without trying to shoo them outside to frolic and live life. And then you can think someone is the nicest, sweetest old person, and then find out they used to use skulls for their victims as dinnerware. Remember that handcrafted soup bowl you ate out of? Eh?
You're scaring me now.
Good. Mission accomplished. Okay, onward to scenario number two. We have sweet old sister Mary Beth Halo of the Our Lady of Perpetual Lies Church.
Do you mean life?
Same thing. So, Sister Mary Beth is cheerfully walking along the street with her bag of groceries when a tattooed thug with a mohawk, we'll call him Cutthroat, pulls her in the side alley and knocks the food out of her hand to the floor. He holds a switchblade up to her face and he demands her money. Now, who's the psychopath here? This is easy, right? I mean, it's the thug who looks like he's out of a Mad Max film. But let's delve behind the scenes. Let's say his real name is Harold. He's got a wife and two babies at home. He was recently fired from his accountant job for being accused of sexual harassment when he was the one actually harassed. But the woman lied like a pro. So as the months passed, their bank account dropped, and their babies go hungry as Harold's wife's considering the world's oldest profession to bring in some cash, Harold desperately needs money. So he shaves his head, puts on phony tattoo sleeves, and looks for the simplest victim he could find that won't put up a fight so no one has to get hurt. He figures Sister Mary Beth in her nun outfit lives at the church and is spending their money, not her own. So the church has got it covered with all those big donations. So, is he a psychopath or just desperate? Probably a sociopath or, again, just desperate. So, see, don't be quick to judge, quick to jury, and quick to execute. And as for our lovely sister Mary Beth, once she sees Harold, that he can't do it and he drops the knife and breaks down and cries, she does what comes natural to her. And for her, that's grabbing the knife and stabbing him 37 times as she maniacally laughs until the tip breaks off in him. You see, sweet elderly Mary Beth Halo is really depraved serial killer Dahlia Wild, who's been on the run for 23 years since that Vegas incident left 8 dead and 3 blackjack dealers in a coma. She's been able to hide away her true identity, but hiding her lust for violence has been hard, and when she saw an opening, she took it.
This is outrageous. Where's the clues to detect any of this?
Well, that brings us to tip number 3. If it seems clear, that's when you should have fear. See, nothing is what it seems. So all the warning signs that seem obvious went out the window with this one. And it's good to understand scenarios like this, because then you don't let your guard down and get blindsided. Do you know who takes shortcuts through a dark alley? Victims!
You're unhinged.
But I'm right. If you were really looking close for signs, then you would have saw that Harold was shaking in fear. Beth was not. She actually had a devious little smile across her face, and she was alive again after years in hiding.
You didn't tell us any of that.
I'll ruin this with petty details. Oh, and one last thing. BD Swingin' happened to be walking by, and he was the one who called the cops.
Oh, well, that was good of him.
Yeah, he was on his way home from the hardware store where he had just bought a shovel and lime to bury his secretary. And that brings us to the end of our show. Many thanks to AI today.
I think I may turn you in.
And thank you, my listeners, for sharing your time with us on our 9th podcast. Please follow us and spread the word that no matter how crappy your day is going, no matter how much you'd like to run screaming from an afternoon bar crowd of professional degenerates and sociopaths and psychopaths, relief is in the form of a little bit of fact, fiction, and fun, just a click away. Later, all. Affirmative.